Man, I'm going to miss this intro. I love the new one, but I'm going to miss this pumped up music when I get started. Hey, good morning. My name is Koen Prins. I'm part of the pastoral lead team here in Thousand Hills. And it's my privilege to bring the last sermon in the Jesus Is series. And I just want to start off with asking you a question. How many of you went outside yesterday? How many of you had a barbecue yesterday? All right, I had a barbecue with a bunch of friends in someone's garden. Actually, I didn't barbecue myself. It was more like a bring and let Antonio barbecue type of deal, which is brilliant because he's a lot better at it than I am. And it's almost so fun when it's June and the sun starts shining, how we in the Netherlands, we celebrate it. And we all go outside to celebrate the sunshine. Oh, I want the sunshine. Finally, you're back. Finally, it's warm. I can wear my shorts again and flip-flops. And it's beautiful. And maybe you're from another culture, maybe if you're from a warmer culture, warmer country, then you get the same feeling like, oh, I remember. Oh, the sunshine is beautiful. The funny thing is, once I experienced the exact opposite of this, celebration of rain. I was in South Africa, where my wife is from, as many of you know, married to Anya, who's from Beaufort West in South Africa. And it's a very dry land. Actually, the area where she's from is called the Karoo, and in the Khoikhoi language, it means dry land. So it's just asking for trouble when you live there. It's a dry land. And I was there a couple of years ago in January, which is their summer, and it was hot. And they had a drought for 3 years. Their big water reservoir, which is like as high as this building, was empty. There was no water. And some parts of the city had been cut off on some days off water, so it'd be 40 degrees and sweaty, and you couldn't shower because there was no water. And I was there in January, they had a drought of 3 years, and at some point it started raining. I remember the family sprinting outside on the porch, looking, oh, it's raining, look at the beautiful rain on the ground, it's so wonderful. And so I was standing, oh, rain, and I was like, okay. She's come to the Netherlands and experienced some rain. Like, this is what we do with the sunshine. You're like, oh, the sunshine. So it was really funny to experience that. And it reminded me of Psalm 63, where it says, "You are, you, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there's no water." And it reminded me of how we can be spiritually thirsty, how we can feel like we live in a dry land where there's no water, and we just long for that drop of rain, we just long for it because we need it. Thirst for God, spiritual thirst is a theme in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. You'll find many quotes like this. Another psalm says, "As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God?" So our spiritual thirst is compared to real thirst for water. You know, our body is designed in such a way that we need water. We can't survive for more than 2 days without water. We'll just die. And in the same way, I believe that God designed us in such a way that we need Him as much as we need water. That we're designed with that same spiritual thirst. If we don't get enough of Him, if we lack God in our lives, then we become thirsty, and it becomes we sort of feel like we're dehydrated. Today's sermon is about Jesus is living water. You can fill in the blank today with living water, because Jesus is the fulfillment, basically, of the thirst. He's the only one that can quench this thirst in us. We're going to look at John 7, verse 37 to 38. It says there, on the last day of the feast, I'm going to explain more about this feast. Jesus stood up and said in a loud voice, he said, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him." Today we're going to look at the invitation in this short passage. The invitation, "If anyone is thirsty, come to me and drink." But also the promise, streams or rivers of living water will flow from within him. It's a promise that Jesus is giving. But first, I want to look with you at the context of what happened. Because Jesus said this at a particular feast, and it's called the Feast of Tabernacles, which in Hebrew is called Sukkot. And feasts like this one were very important in the Jewish religion, in their culture, because it was a sort of constant reminder throughout the year of who God was, what his character is, what his covenant is like. It reminded them of their exodus out of Egypt. And it was sort of, it made them aware of who God was. It's very important to undergo the rituals and the celebration and recite certain verses for them to be reminded who God is, what his character is like. And so this feast was a very joyful occasion, very very happy, dancing, celebrating, Thanksgiving. It's like the Jewish Thanksgiving, really. And it was to remind them of God's provision of water, of rain, of sunlight, so that it would be a good harvest. And so the whole feast was also a prayer for a good harvest, which is, of course, in that time very important for us too, but you know, we're not so aware of it. They a lot more. And so what they did also, they built tents as a reminder of their exodus out of Egypt. They built tents out of branches, a bit like this one. This is a bit amateuristic. It's supposed to only have an open roof, or just with branches so that both rain and sunlight come in, both reminding them of God's provision, of God's blessing for them, which was what they were celebrating. And central in this whole feast was the water ritual. And they would do this every day, a whole parade of musicians and worshipers and priests would go from the temple to the pool of Siloam. How do you say it in English? Siloam. And they would go there singing and dancing and the whole parade. And then they would draw water with a golden jar. They would draw water, reciting Isaiah 12, which says, with joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. So you could also drew water. And they would go back with this whole parade, back to the temple, and in this big silver basin, they would pour it in as a sort of... the whole thing was a prayer for God's provision of rain, so that they would have a good harvest. And it was a thank. They expressed their thankfulness for God's blessing for them. Some of you are looking at me like, that sounds like a party I would want to go to. Not really. That sounds boring. It's true, different times. Compared to when the Dutch win the World Cup in a couple of weeks from now, there will be a big canal parade of the Dutch team in Amsterdam, a bit like this. Compared to that, like a big celebration, shouting, craziness, and singing, and ole, ole, something like that. Or maybe the color run, I think it happened yesterday, where a whole bunch of people in white t-shirts go for a run, and then every kilometer they get a new color on them. Something like this, some joyful, something like that. Think of something like that. Maybe the Awakening Conference here in Thousand Hills. A joyful occasion, celebration. And not only was the meaning of this whole feast and this water ritual especially, not only was it a reminder of God's blessing or a prayer for God's blessing, they also, part of this is also a prayer for the coming of the Messiah, because they knew that when the Messiah would come, he would pour out the Holy Spirit on them, and not only on them, but on all nations that would celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles with the Israelites. In the midst of this, on the biggest day, on the last day, the biggest day, with the most puha on this whole ritual, Jesus stands up, and in a loud voice, he says, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him." Imagine the impact of what Jesus said there. Everything that they were celebrating, everything that they were praying for, Jesus says, "I'm the fulfillment of all of this. If you are thirsty, come to me and drink. If you long for the Holy Spirit, I'm the giver of the Holy Spirit." Jesus offers reality in the place of a ritual. Imagine the impact it had at that moment when he stood up in the midst of all of this. You know, I believe that we all have a longing for God. We all have a sense of spiritual thirst. You know what it's like to feel spiritually thirsty. Something is lacking. Something is not there that should be there. Something essential. And just, you can still live and you breathe and you can have like fun barbecues with friends and you can go on holiday and it can be joyful, but it's not the same. There's not a sense of fulfillment in there. It's like living in a dry land. Living away from God is like living in a dry land. Anything will do to quench that thirst. Even the things that only will quench it temporarily. When you don't have a living relationship with Jesus, you'll feel thirsty. That thirst will never be quenched completely. You know, we experience periods of drought. I do. I mean, when you live away from God for a while, you just don't open your Bible, you don't pray, you don't... There's days or sometimes weeks that you just feel empty. And it's interesting how usually the things that should actually draw us closer to God, you know, struggles and pain or sickness or worries or stress, the things that should draw us closer to God are usually the things that pull us away from Him, and we try to solve it ourselves. And that's where we feel spiritually dry and just long for something and it's not there. Too often, the things that should pull us to God draw us away from Him. Real thirst, though, can only be quenched by the living God. And Jesus extends His invitation to all of us, Christians and non-Christians, come to Me and drink. It's interesting, earlier in the Gospel of John, Jesus had a very good conversation about this, about the same topic. He was traveling to Galilee through Samaria, and he stopped at the well and met a woman there, a Samaritan woman, and he asked her for a drink. Not like, hey, you want something to drink, but more like, can you give me some water as well, because I've been traveling and I'm thirsty. And the woman is surprised because she's a Samaritan woman, he's a Jewish man. That's a bad combination, and it's weird in that time. So she actually, she reacts really surprised. And the following conversation happens. It's very interesting. Jesus says, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked Him and He would have given you living water. Sir, the woman asked, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? She was thinking of something else. Living water would be as like... water that's not still, that's not just standing somewhere, but that's flowing. And so she didn't get the spiritual meaning. And she's like, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock? And Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water, pointing at the well, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I give will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give will become in them a spring of living water, welling up to eternal life. Everyone who drinks this water will never be thirsty again. You know, when we're thirsty, any type of drink will do. Even the things that will make us even more thirsty. You know, we can be thirsty and then we drink something sweet or something with alcohol and it will just make us thirsty again. Right away, it doesn't solve that thirst. But spiritually, what Jesus gives us will quench that thirst and will give a sense of fulfillment. I think when we're spiritually thirsty, we'll also look in all kinds of places to quench it. I mean, other religions or other things or money or holidays. Just things that just solve it temporarily, but not even completely. Only Jesus will be able to quench the thirst in us. And this invitation, therefore, is going out to all of us, whether we're Christians or non-Christian, or man or woman, or old or young. The invitation goes out to all of us. If you're thirsty, come to Jesus and drink.
thirst is a requirement as well. If you're thirsty, come to me and drink. Thirst is basically what we bring to God. In our relationship with Him, this is what we offer. We offer our thirst and we say, fill us because I need you. We acknowledge our need for Him. Fill me. And this invitation extends to us this morning as well. If you're thirsty, if you're here and you're sitting and you're like, yes, I feel thirsty. I feel like I live in a dry, parched land. Come this morning to Jesus and drink. Acknowledge your need for Him. Turn to Him. Stop turning to all kinds of other things. Turn to Him if you're thirsty. Because His arms are stretched out, open wide. And He's ready to receive you. He's ready to pour His living water in your life. But you know what? Jesus wants to do so much more than just quench our thirst. Just give us living water. He wants to do so much more. He wants to make us a wellspring of living water for the people around us, for our environments. Let's look at a second part of what Jesus said in the temple. He said, whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within him. And by this he meant, this is John's comment on what Jesus said here. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not been glorified. Jesus wants to do more in you than just fulfill your thirst. He wants to make you a well of living water so that you can bless others. And 10 days after Jesus' ascension, on the first day on the, of Pentecost, which was also a feast that they were celebrating in Israel, at Pentecost, he did this. He poured out his Holy Spirit on the believers, on the disciples. And we're just going to read and see what happened there. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. This is where Jesus gives his Holy Spirit to the first believers, to his followers. And what happens in them is just amazing. Remember that before they were scared at the scene of Jesus' arrest before his crucifixion. They all fled. When Peter went to see what happened on that same day, they'd ask him, are you one of his followers as well? And he's like, no, I don't know this man. So he denied Jesus a couple times. Not even a month later, this is what happened. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately they went outside on the big square where a big crowd was, and they started preaching. They started preaching. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. They became bold preachers of the gospel. They were not afraid anymore. They went out into the open with their faith and they started preaching. Isn't it amazing? What the Holy Spirit did in those disciples was huge. It was a radical turn in who they were. So they became bold preachers of the gospel, even willing to die for their message. Another thing that the Holy Spirit did in them is he basically illuminated scripture to them so that they could explain it. He brought everything that Jesus said back into their memories so they could teach it to the churches. There was power to heal suddenly. So where usually you would see Jesus in the gospel saying to a lame man or a crippled man, like, take up your mattress and walk. Now you would see Peter and John walking the streets and saying to someone, in the name of Jesus, pick up your mattress and walk. So there was power, there was authority to heal suddenly because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And another thing that happened, so they started this church revolution. These disciples who then became the apostles started churches everywhere in the Greek world, and even further than that, they started churches changing the cities. They started a church revolution, a church movement that would change the world forever. That same fulfillment of the Holy Spirit that they experienced on the first day of Pentecost, we can experience today as well. Because God never changes. The Holy Spirit never changes. He wants to fill us and change us from the inside out and make us a wellspring of living water for the people around us. You know what I long for? You know what I dream about? Is a church, much like this one, a church that would stand up, fulfilled with the Holy Spirit, and that it will overflow this country. Because I know that the Netherlands is like a dry and parched land spiritually. We get enough rain, but not enough rain from God. We are a land that is just spiritually thirsty, and what is needed is a church that becomes a river to just overflow it. And I believe that God is calling us to do this, and we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit in order to do this. So this invitation to be filled with the Spirit extends out to you this morning as well. If you want to become a well of living water for the people around you, for your family, for your colleagues, for your friends, for the people you meet every day, be filled with the Holy Spirit, because He will enable you to do so much more than what you're naturally capable of. He will fulfill you with a passion for the name of Jesus. He will fulfill you with words of wisdom. He will give you a new prayer language. He will do something in you that you can't stop but just praise God. You know, He doesn't only want to fulfill your thirst. He doesn't only want to quench your thirst this morning. He wants to make you a wellspring of living water. Shall we pray? Father, I just thank You that we can come to You however we feel, whatever situation in life we're in, however far we may seem to be away from You, that Your invitation is always for us. Come to Me and drink. Would You come to Me and just have a drink? Just receive from Me, because You're dry and thirsty. Thank You that Your invitation stands out to all of us, goes out to all of us, and that You want to fill us from the inside out. You want to change something in us. You designed us with a thirst for You. And Lord, when we live away from You, we'll always feel thirsty. But when we come to You, You let us drink. And Father, we're ready for You to pour Your living water over us this morning. When we feel thirsty, we just want to reach out our hands to You this morning. Fulfill us. Fill us. Do something new. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord, that with You we'll never have to walk through that desert alone, that You're there with us. That You'll never run out. Father, I just pray that You'll give us a desire for Your Holy Spirit this morning. A desire to be filled with Your Holy Spirit, to be changed from the inside out, to renew our passion for Your name. Give us a sense of our mission that You've given us. And Father, as I remember someone prophesied over this church once, we'll be, as we're on a hill, that from this church, there will be a river flowing over Hilversum, a river of Your life. That this will be a source of life. This will be a wellspring of living water. Father, I just pray this morning that You will fill us with the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus. Amen.